ReReviews, Stardew Valley. Yay! Pre-review. I actually didn't have very high expectations when it came to Stardew Valley, mostly because I had played a couple other, like, farming sims. The game that originally came to mind when I was looking at Stardew Valley was actually Harvest Moon Tree of Tranquility. It was, like, the only Harvest Moon game I had played, and it did not do many favors for the franchise. Tree of Tranquility was just boring. It was boring and tedious, and I didn't like it at all. I found it... I would have preferred to actually make my own farm than play the game. That's never a good thing. When you actually want to do literal, physical, manual work rather than play the game, that's not a good sign. Encouragingly enough, though, I now realize that concerned ape, you know, Eric Barone, who created Stardew Valley, pined for the early days of Harvest Moon, which I was not familiar with, and so that's really the reason why he created Stardew Valley. So, not really having a frame of reference for that, I wasn't sure if I was going to really like this. But then I also remembered another game that I played that was also a farming sim called Rune Factory Frontier. And I really liked Rune Factory because it took, like, the farming stuff that I was used to from that one bad Harvest Moon experience I had. But then there was also, like, dungeons and monsters that you would fight and stuff like that. So really, that was the part of Stardew Valley that they promoted that I was like, oh, I guess this is kind of more like Rune Factory than, like, Harvest Moon, because it adds in those elements where there's, like, you know, a dungeon to go down into the cave system, right? And you get to fight monsters and collect stuff. Oh, okay, so it's more like that. Well, I liked that better. Although Frontier did have its quirks, you know, having to have, like, the spirits aligned in each region. There was some weird stuff, but it was enjoyable. It was like the fantasy Harvest Moon. So that's a thing. Also, I was a little bit reserved when it came to the retro style that they had. I've played plenty of games that, like, decided to take the 8-bit, 16-bit MIDI music route in their design, and I have to tell you that I'm usually not a fan. I think that it's typically done to elicit a sense of nostalgia, and it's just retro for the sake of being retro. So I was a little bit concerned about that as well. But I realized that I wanted to try a farming sim again. You know, those two games that I previously mentioned were a ways back. So, you know what? I'm gonna give it a go. I'll see what all of the fuss is about. So I would say on pre-review, I would have given Stardew Valley a 6 out of 10. It was good enough that I wanted to try it, but I wasn't exactly holding my breath. I was really taking it with a grain of salt. Review! You know, the thing most people do. Stardew Valley is an amazing game. It just is. There's really no way around it. From the moment they drop you in, it feels like you have such agency in what you're doing. There's literally, like, this world to explore, and all of these characters that reside inside of it. And I started to realize that the problems that I might have had with previous farming sims that I had played, those fears were allayed very quickly. And it sneaks up on you, too, because you go in thinking to yourself, hey, I'm gonna do some farming, and then I'm gonna go to a cave, and I'm gonna hit things with a sword, and I'm gonna harvest stuff. But then, it, like, sneaks stuff in that feels much deeper than an experience that you were probably looking for, especially in the NPCs. You know, they get into some pretty deep storylines in this. You have, like, substance abuse, and PTSD, and, you know, interpersonal relationships that are not working. You have, like, romantic relationships that ended very badly. You know, the character backstories that you start getting into with all of the people that inhabit this town is really more fleshed out than you might have expected. And then you kind of get invested with everything that's going on. There's also just some wonderful gameplay loops, where you start to realize that you're unlocking things as you're going along, and as you unlock those things, some tasks become easier, and you are able to do things that you couldn't do before. There are long-term goals, and you nurture relationships with all of the other characters, and there are events throughout the year that you go to and you contribute to, and there's just a lot of content. They also really make you feel like you have to lay out your day, you know, because you have a small window of time each day where you can do stuff, and there's a lot of things that you can do, and so from the moment you wake up in the morning, you're thinking about all of the potential that you have in that day. How much can I actually get accomplished? And it's a brilliant critical thinking challenge, and they do it really, really well. To the point where every day you're thinking to yourself, okay, well, what can I do now? What can I do this time? And that's really impressive work. It's brilliant game design because basically it's not just like, what do I want to do today? It's also, what do I want to do tomorrow, this week, this season? And oh, the seasons are brilliant because each season means that there are different crops that you can harvest. There's different stuff you can forage for. There's just a complete change in atmosphere, and it changes the music. Oh, the music. The music is wonderful, it's beautifully composed, and it really elicits a wonderful sense of each season. You really feel like they are not just reskinned versions of each season. They feel completely new and fresh every time you come across them. It is frankly a really addictive game that you will end up playing for like 100 hours or more, and you will probably not even understand why, but it will not take you long before you're like, oh, I got all of these ancient fruit seeds, and now I can put the ancient fruit seeds in that greenhouse that I finally was able to unlock, and now I can just manufacture ancient fruit wine, and before you know it, you're like, I am a corporation. On my little farm in Stardew Valley. It's around the time that you find yourself as an industrialist that you may want to take a step back, but it is super fun up to that point, and really feels like you are continuously making progress and enjoying this world. Because even though there's tons of great stuff to do and goals to achieve, it also maintains a certain feeling of calm. You know, that it's just simply there to be enjoyed. Because if you wanted to, you could play for like 50 years in-game, and it's not like the game's gonna punish you, you know? It's just gonna let you roll with it. And that's pretty great. There's so much content, there's so much to do, so much to enjoy, and so much depth underneath the surface, that it's hard not to recommend it, even to people who might not necessarily like this kind of game. And the fact that it was created by one guy, you know, Eric Barone, who basically did this all himself, is truly remarkable. It's a great story, if nothing else, but it was also really well executed and really well done. You know, we talk about art in so many cases as collaborative experiences, but when you see one that's literally done by a person, and that it is a singular vision in the most literal sense, it is remarkable when it ends up being as good as Stardew Valley is. On review, I give Stardew Valley a 9 out of 10. Re-review! Here we go. So a couple things that I did for this re-review is actually I started a new character so that I could, you know, start playing from the beginning. Because I wanted to see, you know, kind of remember what it felt like when I originally played it. And I also went back into my established game that I've been playing for like 100 and something hours to, you know, go back in and check on my farm, my maple groves, and my ancient fruit wine production center. What I was absolutely shocked by is that it does not take long when you start a new game to start feeling the same addictive quality as when you've been playing for 100 hours on an established game. You can go back in, play a new character, and all of a sudden, it's like, oh yeah, it's just as much fun, but now I'm armed with experience. So now I know what I'm doing. It becomes instantly enjoyable, and when you have, like, character cutscenes and stuff like that, you're like, oh wow, yeah, I remember this. This was great. I forgot about these parts, and I knew where I was going and what I was supposed to do. I had knowledge. But I also, like, forgot a lot of things. Like, my first thing that I thought of was, oh right, berries. But then I realized that the berries are not actually for sale when you first start. Like, that first spring, I was like, I'm gonna plant strawberries, but the strawberries weren't actually available. And I kind of understood the reason why, because when people realize that, you know, you can get multiple harvests out of berries, yeah, you'd probably spam that pretty early. But the game is trying to get you acclimated to the basic mechanics right up at the front. So it's good, because then you have something to look forward to the next season. Or that I couldn't go to the mines first day, which I did not mind. I understood exactly the reason why they did that, because that's something that you're supposed to kind of grow into, and you can kind of learn about that in the community center, but not on day one. They want you to be able to kind of get a grasp on the basic mechanics on day one, and then by the end of like the first week or so, then they start to introduce some of these other elements, which really keeps you engaged. You're like, oh, now I can do the community center stuff, and oh, now I can go into the mines, and that's great. Oh, now I can go off to the desert. Okay, cool. They just keep adding some stuff in that very short period of time to remind you about, like, all of these new things, but to kind of, like, introduce them slowly so that you don't have everything thrown at you immediately. And I forgot about that, but they did it, and I appreciate it. Oh, and the other thing that I realized, remember at the start of this video I was talking about how I didn't like the retro art styles? I realized that for Stardew Valley, that retro art style and the musical score and everything actually future-proofs it in a way that most AAA games do not get. Because if you think about it, you can go back to look at the original God of War, and by today's standards, it'd be like, yeah, the graphics are kind of rough. Stardew Valley will always look just as good as it did when it released. 30 years from now, Stardew Valley will look just as good as it did the day it was released. It future-proofed itself because of its retro style. That was forward thinking to the extreme. But it's true, a lot of these big titles that are not like the indie developed titles, or even ones that are just trying to show how great the resolution is on their product, you'll see them go back and have to do remasters or to do the HD or the 4K resolution changes so that they still look good, even though it's only been like 5 years, 6 years since it was made. And there's a reason for that, because it doesn't take long for those graphics to start to lose their luster. But Stardew Valley looks as good as it ever could, and that is brilliant. So good. And Concerned Ape is still supporting the game, still coming out with patches, still coming out with new content, both for the single player and the thing that is a real change since its original inception, the multiplayer. I have been very fortunate to be able to play the multiplayer version of Stardew Valley. I got to play it on Twitch. I got to play it over on Andy Watson's channel. Which you should totally check out, because she does more than just stream games that I happen to be in. Noting that I am not a multiplayer guy. In fact, I usually abhor when they spend so much time working on a multiplayer component to something that really should be a single-player focused game. Stardew Valley works brilliantly as a multiplayer. And it makes things so much faster and streamlined when you have multiple people working on tasks. Because you know that whole thing that I was talking about where you have limited time in a day to actually do stuff? Well, imagine if that limited time in the day, those tasks were split between, like, up to four people. Okay, so now you can actually accomplish quite a bit. And you're all sharing the rewards, you know, it's kind of great. You know, being able to do that, and also just hanging out, especially if you have people around you that are, like, playing for the same reasons. If you have a lot of people that love to strategize, you know, that's a great crew. If you have people that just love to go there, hang out, have fun, and enjoy it, that's great. If you have people that just want to learn how the game works, and you have one kind of experienced player or two that just want to be able to show you how cool the game is, That also works out great. I definitely recommend having a voice channel open for that so that you don't have to try typing at each other. You know, you get to actually talk to each other. But, you know, having that cooperative experience and, you know, going through the game like that actually works so well. It really is one of the best examples of a multiplayer experience that I could conceive of. It is absolutely made for that. And I love the fact that they didn't, like, try to figure out how to justify pretty much, like, all of the events in the game. Like, all the players that are playing in that game can experience the different events and the characters and everything like that. And everybody gets an award for, you know, completing a task. And everybody can go and complete those tasks, and the money can kind of get pooled together. They didn't overanalyze the lore for every character in there. You're just enjoying the game. You know, it's like the regular game, but you can have four people playing at the same time. And it's highly recommended if you're, like, just trying to, you know, get together with a bunch of people and you want to play on Twitch or maybe just chat, have a good time. It's also a great game to play for that. Because, as I said, you don't have to be, like, in industry mode. You could also just enjoy the game and, you know, tool around and check out the spa and all of that stuff if you want. Go on raids through the mines and all of that, which is so much easier when someone has your back. Because if you're picking away at the rocks and the bats start coming at you, it's good to have somebody with a sword smacking at them while you're working on something. The game was great to begin with. And as I said, it is future-proofed. It has not aged a day because it practically came out of the gate showing that it couldn't age. But somehow, with, like, the continued updates and keeping on with new content, which, again, is really impressive because it's all free updates. It's not like add-on content being placed into the game that you pay microtransactions for. No, none of that. And especially with the additional co-op mode, which just adds, like, one other whole layer of replayability and enjoyment to this experience. All of it really takes Stardew Valley from being a great game to being near legendary. I do not say that lightly. There are few games that I would really consider to be legend, wait for it, airy. But Stardew Valley is. You could see that, like, 30 years, 40 years down the line, when we all have, you know, like, game jacks in our heads and we're, like, playing in virtual reality, there's gonna be, like, 16K ultra resolution, full body melded experiences for video games. And there is still going to be a market for Stardew Valley. People will still want to play Stardew Valley. There are not a lot of games that have the potential to stand that kind of test of time. Not in video gaming, but I truly think that Stardew is one of them. So on ReReview, I have to give Stardew Valley a 10 out of 10. Not only is it just as addictive an experience and as surprisingly deep an experience as I remember it, but it's also just gotten better with time. The co-op mode just takes it, like, over the edge. And that's coming from somebody who usually hates having to play with other people. Like, I got into video gaming because it was such a, you know, singular experience that I could enjoy myself. And so it's rare coming from me, but it was just done so well and implemented so effectively and just so much fun. And again, really big props to Eric Barone. I know that sometimes it seems like I sing his praises a lot, but I think it's justified. I mean, he created, like, this game by himself, and it's a near endless adventure with tons of great content, quality content, that keeps getting updated. And I'll actually be very interested to see if Concerned Ape decides to do another game down the road. I mean, it's not like he has to, But I wouldn't be averse to another game down the road, just saying, throwing it out there. Again, just gonna give you that nice little recap so that you can see the scores. This one definitely took a different trajectory than AC Origins, but that's kind of the point. You know, sometimes games actually get better and improve over the course of time. And, you know, sometimes they don't. Sometimes they don't hold up. This one is definitely a case where it not only holds up, but somehow ends up being better than when it originally came out, even in the modern gaming space. Thank you everybody for watching yet another ReReview. I'm not really sure what the next ReReview is going to be. Until then, please don't forget to dislike and unsubscribe, because, you know, I'm really trying to get into negative views. I think I'm probably closer than ever to achieving that goal of negative subscribers and negative views. Looking forward to it. Hey, you know what? Take your milestones where you can get it. All right. Bye. All right, year 5, egg hunt. I am an expert at this now. Let's do it. Okay, looking for all the eggs. There's one. Okay, we're doing good. Oh, there's another one. Yeah. No, Abigail, you're not getting it. There's another one. Another one. Grab it. Grab that egg. Sorry, Abby. I'm just too fast. Oh yeah, she's totally gonna like me now. Yep, there's one. And come on, around the tree. There's one. Oh, we're doing good. There's another one. Oh, I see you hiding. Gotcha. Oh no, I'm out of time. Oh. 8 eggs. Yeah. Okay, Lewis, give me my prize. 8 eggs. Come on. No one else could have possibly done that well. Abigail! No, I got all the eggs before. This is rigged. They rigged the egg hunt. I call shenanigans.